many here have ever built a house? Have you built a house? Yeah. You know, from the ground up. So you looked at the lot, you drew up the floor plan, you budgeted out materials, put together the construction timeline, you stayed married through it. It's a task. It's a serious task. Well, imagine looking at a bare mountain and thinking, this can become one of the best ski areas in all of Colorado, all of the world. Vision. And then to actually take that dream and turn it into skiers on the mountain is a quest few in the world would ever have the mind to do, let alone the stomach to be able to do it. Chuck Lewis not only knew the pieces to that puzzle, he knew how to ingeniously craft them together. No, I think John Lindstrom, you would agree if I said he knew how to cement them together, right? And the result is a resort that shines as bright as its name, Copper Mountain.
In 1880, Judge John Wheeler saw potential when he established a mining settlement between Ten Mile and Gore Mountain ranges. The town boomed with miners and loggers, fur traders and prospectors. But Wheeler's development was nowhere near what Chuck Lewis would do. In 1969, Colorado Outward Bound founder Chuck Frohlicher was looking to start a development. The site was suggested by a National Forest Ranger who just completed a survey claiming it's probably the most outstanding potential ski area in the Arapaho National Forest and possibly Colorado. Frohlicher consulted with both Darcy Brown at Aspen and Pete Siebert from Vail. The two agreed there was only one guy who could pull it off, Chuck Lewis. Their confidence sealed the deal. Frohlicher partnered with Lewis, and along with a handful of faithful investors, they purchased 280 acres and named the resort Copper Mountain. Lewis was no ordinary man, and this would be no ordinary ski resort. He studied every aspect, even down to when sun hit the lift terminals on the shortest day of the year. Armed with land, leadership, Forest Service permit and plan, he went hunting the big money for construction. Timing was off. Lewis logged thousands of miles around the world, knocking on doors, but no takers. Ironically, the yes came from a group just 600 feet from his Denver office, Fullen Wider Management and Development and Bailey Companies. Copper Mountain was now a go. Construction began in 1971, and Lewis, a savvy number cruncher, devised cost-saving solutions to every problem, from moving beavers to mining lumber. Rather than hauling trees off-site after clearing trails, he set up the Thick and Thin Lumber Company operating right from the base. And instead of paying big bucks to haul concrete up the canyon, he bought five trucks and started Pretty Lumpy Concrete Company. His humor, as well as his ingenuity, worked. By November 1972, Copper Mountain was ready for business. It's no surprise Lewis had the determination to realize a dream. All his life, this Colorado native was a man of promise, known for cutting through red tape, making a long story short, and getting it done. He started skiing when he was four, and by the time he was in high school, he earned a spot on the junior national team. In college, he went on to compete at Dartmouth, winning the Dartmouth Cup at Arapaho Basin. In 1955, Lewis was called into the Army and went to Mountain and Cold Weather Training Command at Camp Hale. He also made the first U.S. biathlon team to compete in Europe. At 21, Lewis married Penny, his high school sweetheart. The couple had three children, all raised to live and love to ski. He also coached junior national racers, alpine stars like Billy Kidd, Bill Merolt, and Moose Barrows. Lewis's commitment to America's ski industry includes more than developing Copper Mountain. He served as president for the Colorado Ski Country, as well as the National Ski Areas Association. He co-founded Reinsurance Company, providing liability and workman's comp to ski areas, as well as the Ski the Summit Marketing Coalition, establishing Summit County as the most popular ski destination in the world. In 1991, he purchased nearby Eldora Ski Area and then helped reorganize Sugar Bowl Ski Area in California. His pioneering sense for trail design and attention to environmental concerns earned him recognition with the U.S. Forest Service. And because of his work as chairman of the Colorado Division of Wildlife, a state wildlife area is named in his honor. In March of 2000, at just 63, Lewis passed away. Without a doubt, this remarkable force left us far too soon. His talents from creative financier to contractor and customer service specialist to coach have earned him a long list of awards. Penny agrees his real legacy is in the people he mentored. Hardly a person in the industry today was not helped by Chuck Lewis, and for that, we induct him into the U.S. Ski and Snowboard Hall of Fame.
Son Randy will be accepting on behalf of his father, and he's being escorted by his sister, Chrissy Lewis Lynch, and the medal will be presented by Vonda Dyson, the three Lewis children here on the stage. Rocking down the high, Colorado. Rocky Mountain High. Hang on just a second. Oh, you guys, we need Kleenex up here.
You saw everything as far as you can see.
Randy Lewis, on behalf of your father, having been elected by representation of the 14 million skiers and snowboarders in America, we hereby bestow upon you and Stowe, Vermont, our country's highest snow sport award, the Medal of Honor, and confer upon you in his memory from this day forward, April 8th, 2017, induction into the U.S. Ski and Snowboard Hall of Fame, where his accomplishments will forever be remembered.
Well, thank you so much. There's so many people in the room that my mom wanted to be here to see. She wasn't able to come. So from Penny to all of you who know her, she says thank you. Let me just highlight a couple of quick things about my dad. He really was, like many of the passing and current generation of ski area people, a lifelong skier. As the video said, at age 3, it was either go to Winter Park or be left behind. And he was not about to be left behind. He started earning his own lift tickets when he worked on the ski train, selling tickets to other kids for Winter Park, and would get his ticket for free for doing so. He started clearing trails, similar to Michael, at age 15, when Steve Bradley took him under his wing and started letting him learn the mountain aspect. His Sun Valley trip was his graduation present in 1956. In the Army, he managed to turn skiing into his profession and spent his time in the Mountain and Cold Weather Command teaching others to ski, and then on weekends going over to A Basin to teach other people to ski for a little extra money. The video touches on some of the people that he coached with his coaching business that he used to support himself and my mom and us when he was going back to school. And then there was all of his time in the industry from the operating side, from his first meeting with Pete Seibert, which was literally three ring binders in a conference room at Arthur Anderson in downtown Denver. And from there, things just took off. So, there was time in Aspen, there was time in Vail, then there was Copper, then there was Eldora, and there were maybe 3 or 4 dozen ski areas and ski area managers that he consulted to throughout his life. And then his longtime relationship with Graham Anderson, ultimately developed into its own business. He had a passion for revolutionizing, perhaps maybe a better word is professionalizing, the ski industry. He was really among the first to realize, much to his mother's horror, that it could be a real business, and he did have a real job. And so, he was determined. He used to say to us, it's my factory, and I have to go out on the floor every day and check the product and make sure it's working right. And that, of course, that was just a fancy excuse for let's go skiing for a couple hours. But he spent a fascinating amount of time as talking about design and design theory, which is now all the rage in the business schools and consultants speak. But he was doing it intuitively, starting in the late 60s and the early 70s. He was fascinated with the application of customer service models that, you know, are viable and very much a part of the industry today. He spent weeks with the Disney company trying to understand customer engagement, employee enthusiasm programs, risk management programs, how to handle an unhappy customer, and most importantly of all to him, yield management, because he was completely driven by the fact that it was a business and you had to know where the money was at all times. Through the NSAA and his relationship, you know, I've had the chance to talk to the Gravniks and Mr. Conniff tonight. You know, these were very influential people to him and him on them and the industry. I really believed he moved the industry in ways that now we see reflected in the very businesslike aspect of it. But maybe the most lasting part of my dad was his teaching and mentoring. He was a seriously competitive person. He would compete about anything. But he never, ever held on to the secrets. He would share them with anybody. He had a remarkable ability to take disparate ideas from disparate industries and apply them to skiing. He kept moving and growing and encouraged everyone around him to do the same. He was dedicated to creating opportunities for his people no matter where they wanted to go. And he was fiercely loyal and protective of them as long as they kept learning and he kept moving them. He was relentlessly optimistic. Any of you who've met him over the years know that. There was rarely a cloudy day in his world. And he pushed himself and everyone else to see that for themselves. So I leave you with a couple of things. You know, he was really long before it was popular among the crowd to do what you love and going to work every day is really not going to work. He had a phrase, there are no problems, only challenges. And all of those who've been around him know that one by heart. His other famous phrase was, keep moving, don't stand there, get something done, and make a difference. And the most famous one of all, and today was a perfect illustration of that. There are no bad days of skiing.